the discussions of.
I don't want to in any way whatsoever. I just want to make sure that.
So I'll just say we're going to open opening remarks from Madeline, or Professor Morris, Professor Weisburd, and then we'll go to questions after that.
What was the middle one?
Theoretical approaches. So on that one, like I'm going to do a chapter on the notion of a case and situations. Other words would talk about positive complementarity. Bill Burke White will do something on, I think, or Carson maybe thinks something on positive complementarity. And a few other pieces like that. And then the last section really looked at complementarity in practice in Uganda.
You just talk and people
DRC,
listen.
I think, and you know,
excellent
implications possibly for, I think, maybe in Colombia, you know, a few pieces like that. So.
I think we're going to go ahead and get started, guys, if you, Okay, thank you for coming this morning. We'll likely have some other students. A number of students have indicated to me they have an interest in coming this morning, but have class until 9:45. So hopefully it won't be too distracting, but we could well see a stream of some students coming in after we've begun this morning. This is the continuation of the conference that began yesterday afternoon, looking deeper what Darfur tells us about genocide, international criminal law, and the future of a country. For those of you who were here yesterday afternoon, we were lucky to have Rod Rastan, who will be with us again, talking a little bit about the International Criminal Court, and then more specifically the Darfur case, and even more specifically than that, the recent decision of the court to issue the arrest warrant for the President Omar Bashir. We'll talk about that and a couple of other things this morning. What I want to do first is introduce the people that we have up here on the panel. Immediately to my right is Stephen Bornick, the Associate Director of the Center on International Comparative Law, and who will moderate the session. So he'll be peppering the panelists with questions, but then, of course, we'll also entertain plenty of questions from those of you who are here. Next to him is Professor Madeline Morris. Professor Morris is a professor here at Duke. She has probably most known for many of the Duke students here as the leader of the Guantanamo clinic that's done quite a lot of work on four detainees at Guantanamo. She's also served as a member of the U.S. Secretary of State's Advisory Committee on International Law and as Chief Counsel to the Office of the Chief Defense Counsel for Military Commissions at the Defense Department, as well as a number of other positions both in government and outside of it. Next to her is Professor Mark Weisburd. Professor Weisburd is a professor at the University of North Carolina, the Carolina School of Law. He teaches predominantly in international law, also civil procedure. He's done quite a lot of work in human rights law as well as humanitarian law. And again, he's also had a range of experiences both in private practice with the government and, of course, now as an academic. And then, again, for those of you who were here yesterday, you know, seated at the far right is Rod Rastan. Rod is currently a legal advisor in the Office of the Prosecutor at the International Criminal Court, which he's done for the past 5 years. So quite long experience with a quite young institution. Before that, he also brings a range of experiences working largely with the UN in the field of human rights. He's spent time in, among other places, East Timor, Bosnia, and Cyprus. So without any further ado, Stephen will be sort of guiding the panelists, putting some questions to them, but then we just hope to have this as an open conversation. So thank you.
Thank you, James, and I'd like to thank everyone for coming this morning. It's great to see the students so actively engaged. They've really put on some great panels and planned an excellent conference. As James said, I'm Stephen Bornick. I'm the Associate Director of SICL, and I'm going to be moderating. Maybe I'll be a referee. I'll be keeping time and also directing questions. I have some questions here, but to start, I think what we'll do is go ahead and have some comments from Professor Morris and Professor Weisburd. Mr. Rastan had an excellent spiel yesterday, and I think that he will be the third to talk and maybe rebut some of the points made. From there, we'll open up with some questions that I have, and then we'll move into questions from the audience. So, Professor Morris.
Okay, I'm just going to take a few minutes to suggest that if we look at the track record and the effects of international criminal tribunals from Nuremberg forward, the prospects are not very bright for positive outcomes or benefits. If we look at them in terms of the usual stated goals of criminal law, rehabilitation, incapacitation, deterrence, retribution, we get very low scores on all for all tribunals, and I'll talk a little bit about each of those. There's a suggestion that's been made in the last few years that there's really an additional function and that this is the one primarily or largely addressed by international criminal tribunals, and that's an expressive function, the function of condemning the conduct in question and thereby strengthening the norms against the criminalized conduct. And with regard to that, I will come back to each of those and I'll ask whether, if we are seeking an expressive function, whether the international tribunals that we are conducting and envision conducting expresses the appropriate sentiments. Nuremberg, Tokyo, immediately after World War II, these tribunals existed in a post-war context. That is, the hostilities were over, the atrocities, therefore, had ended, and the regime had changed. In that context, it's hard to, especially for the first in what becomes a series of courts, it's hard to judge the effects. Certainly, there's some benefit in terms of the way procedures were handled in Nuremberg, if not in Tokyo. There was serious attention paid to the rule of law and to basic criminal law, procedural and substantive principles, though there were ex post facto problems. Moving into the subsequent tribunals, I'll spend a bit more time. In 1993, the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia is created, this time in the midst of an ongoing war with atrocities ongoing at the time of the creation of the tribunal, a tribunal dedicated specifically to scrutinizing and prosecuting those committing atrocities in that particular time and location, no apparent effect on the continuation of atrocities. Would there have been fewer? There did not seem to be any reduction in the rate or type of atrocities that were being committed in the former Yugoslavia until the military intervention of NATO in Kosovo, which pretty rapidly brought the war overall and consequently the atrocities to an end. The initial period, while the hostilities were ongoing, were a period in which governments then in place who found the ICTY adverse to their interests, that is in particular the government of Serbia, but others as well, stonewalled the tribunal, did not cooperate, and cooperation with the tribunal didn't really start in any meaningful way until there was regime change, a new regime, at such a time in the new regime when the new regime saw it as in its political best interests to start to comply because of U.S. support and aspirations to join the European Union and so on. So, again, there's no observable incapacitatory, rehabilitative, deterrent effect that we can see by the creation of the ICTY in terms of its effect on conduct during the hostilities or any apparent power even after the hostilities in terms of gaining cooperation from states not seeing that cooperation as being in their interests. 116 judgments to date in the ICTY at a cost of $1.3 billion. Also cost the genocide decision in the Srebrenica case we could talk about, but a finding of no genocide, focusing that case so unfortunately in my view on particular, hi Jerry, on particular questions about the, I hate the word, but technicalities, the some of the inner workings of genocide law, rather than on the crimes against humanity that certainly were committed, whether they could be said to be genocide or not. ICTR, International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda, was created following a decisive military intervention that ended the atrocities in Rwanda. New regime came in immediately. And so again, we don't know what effect the creation of an ICTR would have had on the genocide in Rwanda. It ended before the creation of the tribunal. What we do know is that in that region, and particularly in eastern Congo, atrocities and massacres and such behavior has continued unabated to date, notwithstanding the existence of the ICTR. To be sure, its temporal jurisdiction would not cover current atrocities. So you could say, well, that's why it's not having a deterrent effect, but the fact of the ICTY's existence, the ICTR's existence, the prospect of a new tribunal, and the presence of the ICC and the existence of the ICC all have not had any apparent effect in the Central African situation. And the ICTR is now closing down. It's finishing up its operations with a total of 31 completed judgments, sending a large number of defendants back to Rwanda, where they will be tried in some in national courts and many in these gachacha village level judicial bodies that have been created for the purpose. At a cost of $1.1 billion in a desperately poor country. Question whether more could have been done with $1.1 billion to improve the lives of people in Rwanda, or indeed the quality of justice in Rwanda. Sierra Leone, special court for Sierra Leone was set up in a different way, mixed organization comprised of UN and domestic Sierra Leonean components. Again, hostilities are already over, the atrocities have ended. Again, because of a decisive military intervention, largely by Britain, regime changed, the new regime is in favor of the tribunal. Again, very few judgments. The first one was of a person who had really been sort of a national hero and in some ways could be said to have saved Sierra Leone from the other side who had committed most of the atrocities, but that was the department that was ready to go forward at that time and in some ways was the even-handed thing to do. The proceedings are largely unknown to most of the population in Sierra Leone in terms of what little information has been gathered through various outreach projects. There's certainly an awareness that it's ongoing, but does not seem to be a focus of great attention. I would imagine that, and I don't know this, the fact of the arrest and now prosecution of Charles Taylor, who was president of Liberia and very centrally involved in the atrocities that occurred in Sierra Leone, has much more impact than some of the other information, but I have not seen any feedback gathered on that question. What we do know about the Taylor indictment was that at first the indictment of Charles Taylor, then the sitting head of state of Liberia, was sealed, and it was unsealed by the prosecutor of the Special Court for Sierra Leone at the beginning of a peace conference held in Ghana that was to concretize a peace in Liberia where things had been very violent up until that time and looked as though there might be some resolution possible at that moment. Peace conference is held. David Crane, the then prosecutor, goes from Freetown, Sierra Leone to Accra for this peace conference. Charles Taylor shows up for the peace conference. David Crane, without consulting with the Ghanaians or Americans or Brits who were all involved in the politics of that conference, unseals the indictment and asks the Ghanaians to arrest Charles Taylor. Ghanaians sit on their hands. Charles Taylor gets on a plane and goes back home, and massacres ensue in Monrovia. ICC, I don't see much different. I see idealism and failure at a great cost in terms of money that could be made available otherwise, perhaps to better effect for victims. And now, with the indictment issuance of the arrest warrant for the president of Sudan and the president of Sudan's incredible response, predictable but unthinkable, of expelling the non-governmental organizations that have been helping the population to avoid the ultimate worst outcomes. I mean, it's hard to know what would be the ultimate worst outcomes. It gets worse and worse, and now worse yet because of the expulsion of some critical NGOs. And indeed, the president has made a big show of traveling outside the country and demonstrating that he can do as he pleases and that neither he nor apparently these other countries are too concerned about the International Criminal Court. So he says in this week's New York Times. Incapacitation, probably, apparently not. Rehabilitation, not even claimed. Deterrence, I don't see it. Used to be said it earlier in the 90s, well, it's going to take some time. Once there's some track record here, then we're going to see the deterrent effect. Retribution, maybe some. For lots of victims, not the people that they would have had in mind, not the people that came and murdered their mother in their hut. And is retribution, in any case, what we want to be aiming at and expending these resources on? Certainly, it's not the usual argument for why these are worth pursuing. And as to the expressive function, I think that what's expressed really is that when there's a political will and reasons, there's a military intervention and atrocities are stopped, and when there isn't, they're not. And then sometimes afterwards, there is a tribunal, and sometimes afterwards, there isn't. And when there is, that may be beneficial or harmful to the immediate victims. Perfect. One time I said to Richard Goldstone, who was then the prosecutor for the ICTYSTR, this is not helping in Rwanda. Here are the reasons. And he was standing with one of the trial attorneys in his office, and he said, that's a risk we have to take for the long run. That's what I see us doing, or the ICC doing, or whoever we are, in Darfur right now. Taking that risk for the long run with other people's lives. Thank you.
Thank you. Professor Morris has certainly raised some provocative comments. I'm sure Mr. Rastan will want to respond as well, Professor Weisburd, but I know that you've prepared as well a few comments.
I do. And I want to essentially address I guess the best way to say it would be ways of evaluating the performance of the ICC. And in my own mind, I've broken that down into two different categories. One would be the effectiveness of the ICC in carrying out the tasks assigned by its statute. The second point would be the utility of the operation of the ICC, not simply in the framework of taking its statute for granted, but rather asking the question, are we better off because there is an ICC than we would be if there were not an ICC? Now, with respect to effectiveness in the terms of the statute, certainly for some purposes, it's much too early to judge. There hasn't been time to accumulate as much evidence as one might want. I would point out, however, an area of disagreement between myself and Mr. Rastan yesterday. Yesterday, he pointed out that the arrest function is not assigned to the staff of the ICC by the statute, that enforcement arrest depends on the cooperation of states. And while that's true, I think if one is going to evaluate the effectiveness of the ICC in terms of accomplishing the task assigned to it, one can't really ignore the difficulties simply of taking suspects into custody. Those currently in custody are in custody because their own governments chose to have the ICC prosecute rather than prosecuting them themselves. Surely, I think anyone, including the staff of the ICC, would agree that if its arrest warrants are seldom, if ever, executed, unless it turns out to be politically expedient for reasons utterly unrelated to the gravity of the charges, that's going to raise questions about the effectiveness of the ICC in the long term. With respect to the overall utility, Professor Morris, of course, expressed a somewhat negative view. I think she was soft on it myself. A little history, I think, is helpful here. There seems to be a consensus that the Yugoslav Tribunal was created, to borrow a term from Mr. Rastan, as a fig leaf for the absolute unwillingness of Western powers to use military force to prevent ethnic cleansing and other atrocities in Bosnia-Herzegovina. It was an attempt to pretend that something effective was being done, as it were, to shield people from their own unwillingness to take action with respect to crimes that they claimed to see as very much demanding a response. I say claimed, of course, because if you really care that much, you do something. If you don't do something, apparently you don't really care. So we start off with a somewhat checkered history. On the one hand, the fundamental rationale for the institution is that it's going to contribute in some way to dealing with massive atrocities. And in figuring how it impacts on that, it seems to me that one can break down a potentially effective response into stopping the atrocities, addressing whatever situation led to the atrocities in the first place so that they don't resume as soon as foreign military forces get on their airplanes and go somewhere else. And only after those two objectives are accomplished, turning to figuring out whether some sort of criminal proceedings would be useful. Now, the problem with the International Criminal Court is, to the extent that some sort of military intervention would be necessary to stop atrocities in a particular situation, of course, it's not in a position to deliver that. Indeed, no proponent of the court is ever pretending that it would be. That's simply not the job of the court. But to the extent that one is truly concerned about stopping the atrocities, it would seem that's where the focus initially has to be. The second point, that is, dealing with the situation that led to the atrocities, is something, frankly, that I surprises me a little. It may be just that I don't pay enough attention to the literature, but I don't think that that attracts as much attention as it should. There are going to be cases where local regime change is going to produce a new regime that is, in fact, capable of addressing those situations. We haven't seen that yet, really. In both Bosnia-Herzegovina and Kosovo, there is still what amounts to foreign oversight. In Rwanda, we have a situation where there hasn't so much been a reconciliation between the sides as, in essence, one side won, one side lost, and the side that lost sees itself simply as having been on the wrong end of a war. Not that is a group of people who perpetrated atrocities, but a group of people who tried to defend themselves and weren't successful. I belabor this because if one is serious about dealing with massive atrocities, it seems to me one has to think about the future of the place where the atrocity is taking place, even if foreign military intervention is able to stop the shooting. That, in some ways, leads to notions of what amounts to recolonization. Again, a subject that doesn't attract as much attention as it might. I would suggest that to a certain extent, what this phenomenon reflects is sort of a mindset that a legal approach is valuable in and of itself. Indeed, it picks up on Judge Goldstone's comment that the costs are acceptable for the future. Well, that assumes that creating legal precedents is somehow a worthy undertaking in and of itself without regard to the consequence on the ground. And it is not at all clear to me, dear as precedents are to lawyers, that the rest of the world would necessarily assess it in the same way. Finally, last point. When I started teaching international law in 1981, one of the foundation stones of the discipline was the absolutely fundamental character of the right of self-determination. One doesn't hear so much about the right of self-determination anymore. And I mention that not because I think it's important necessarily, but sort of as a prudential lesson. That which was considered essential at one point turns out not quite 30 years later not to be so essential after all. What will that tell us about international criminal law in 30 years?
Thank you, Professor Weisburd. Excellent comments, and I'm sure Mr. Rastan has many things to say about both of your comments.
Well, you're giving me a tough job first thing in the morning. Thanks so much for inviting me again. And I think these are all very much the critical questions about the validity of the whole project of international justice. So I think it's very useful that we're having this discussion. I think they're all valid points. I mean, I'll try to offer some thoughts, but I can't say that, you know, there isn't a point to be discussed. I think, you know, it deserves critical treatment. I think some of the goals that have been set out for what the International Courts is trying to achieve, whether they're deterrence or retribution, their effectiveness, expressive values, they're not dissimilar to the same goals that are applied at the domestic level. I know you can't extrapolate and compare and contrast directly the national process with the international. But I mean, the deterrent value of criminal sanction has not been proved at the domestic level. So, and also its usefulness in terms of retributive value and many of the other goals that have been mentioned could be also questions at the domestic level. So, I mean, that question would then bring into doubt the whole purpose of a criminal process at all at any level. I know at the international level there are particular features which make it dissimilar because you're talking about criminality, which goes to the heart of the structure of a state. But I think the goals of the ICC seek to contribute towards, I think, prevention. But I think that's not the primary purpose. I don't think also the goal of the ICC is to stop crimes. I think it's correct to say that these international courts and tribunals cannot be seen as replacements for other action that may be required. And indeed, I mean, the discussion at the time of the formation of the Yugoslavia Tribunal was the Security Council was unable to agree in terms of military intervention, and the perception was that they had to be seen to be doing something, and that one of the responses considered was that there has to be a judicial mechanism. It wasn't the only mechanism, though humanitarian, there was peace negotiations, there were discussions about intervention, but among one of the components, the justice component was seen as being essential. And at the time, many people doubted whether or not it would be successful and said that this is, as mentioned, perhaps a smokescreen for the more robust intervention. I think one cannot project on international courts and tribunals the expectations that they will be the panacea and that they will be the solution to all of these problems, or that they will stop atrocities. I don't think that's what they're set up to do. I think they're set up to be part of the process to contribute to finding a more durable solution to address the situation. And to that extent, I think they have played important roles. The usual refrain that's given that you can't have peace without justice. We've seen numerous situations around the world where the absence of an accountability process, whether criminal or otherwise, the failure to combat impunity, has led to armed groups not feeling threatened in terms of the prospect of resorting again to violence, and you've seen the return to acts of atrocities in numerous situations around the world. And for example, this Sierra Leone is a good example. In 1999, they had the Lome Peace Accords, where basically there was an imposition of an amnesty across the board, and that didn't have any deterrent impact either. Violence again was precipitated, and then after the new wave of violence, the international community started to take a different approach. Within that approach was the notion that there will be no amnesty for the perpetrators of most serious crimes. I think also it raises the broader question of what is international justice supposed to do. Some of the criticisms about ad hoc tribunals and courts and tribunals, I think, are valid in terms of their dislocation from the scene of the crimes, their remoteness in terms of their perception reception by the local communities, whether or not they've contributed to reconciliation, their huge costs. And I think the ICC and the Rome Statute sets up to do something different. And I think that's also a point which I'd like to to put forward and to seek views on. When it came to negotiating the Rome Statute, the drafters set out to do something that's quite different. If you look at the Rome Statute, most of the preamble, for example, talks about not about the court, but about national authorities. It says that the court is, the Rome Statute is adopted in order to ensure that these types of crimes are not unpunished, and that effective prosecution is taken at the national level by enhancing international cooperation. It recalls the duty of every state to exercise its criminal jurisdiction. It recalls generally the fact that these crimes threaten peace and security. And then it recalls that an international court is set up that's complementary to national jurisdictions. And I think that's a critical point here for me. The Rome Statute is not about setting up an international court as such. That's not the only goal. The Rome Statute is about setting up a system for the enforcement of international criminal law and for the enforcement of the norms that have been established in numerous treaties, Genocide Convention, Geneva Conventions, and others. So the emphasis within the Rome Statute framework is that national authorities will take measures. And that's the most effective way in terms of the utility of the process. And I think in terms of the overall goals of judiciability, accountability process and a justice process, one must ordinarily look for domestic responses to these types of atrocities. But what the court does, what the statute does, it places those pre-existing obligations and commitments that states have signed up to into a framework where if there is a failure at the national level because of an unwillingness or inability of national authorities to undertake genuine processes, then that responsibility gets shifted to the international level, and the ICC is there as a backup. So it's a system of incentives and coercion. And we were discussing yesterday in the context of R2P, perhaps, but the notion that the responsibility resides, first of all, at the national level, and then maybe is shifted to the international level. What the Rome Statute seeks to do is to set up this type of system to encourage, principally, domestic action. So the ICC basically is looking, as a court, are looking to put ourselves out of a job to the extent that we can act as a catalyst for domestic prosecution. Now, whether that will work or not is yet to be seen. It's still early days. I think the jury's out. And also the appropriateness of the ICC interventions. At what point should it intervene? At what level? What is the best way it can maximize its catalytic effect? Are things that will probably be discussed as we go into the future. But if that is the case, if the court does act as a catalyst, if its interventions are very measured and precise and focused, then the issue also of cost it becomes a shared burden, and the ICC's role is to basically nudge the process forward, and then the majority of the work is done at the national levels. As we were discussing yesterday after Nuremberg, a few cases in Nuremberg and subsequent proceedings in the military jurisdictions of the Allied powers led to the majority of trials happening in domestic courts during the post-World War II period. And I mentioned 60,000 trials in West Germany, for example, the lustrations and other processes. In Bosnia today, I mean, I worked in Bosnia many years, and the ICTY is seen as quite remote for many people, but there's now after 10-15 years, there are now national processes going on in Serbia and Croatia and Bosnia responding to those situations. And I think it's not just a question of idealism. This is real politics. I mean, these individuals who were within the wartime machinery are the same individuals who are then running the government. And it's the same individual that you turn to for humanitarian assistance, for post-war recovery, for governance. And the war criminals of yesterday often become the organized criminals the officials who are holding back progress of today. One of the reasons why, for example, there has been a convergence of state interest in terms of dealing with these types of atrocities, I think, for example, for the European Union, we can observe that there they, as a bloc, they decided that they were not going to admit countries from the former Yugoslavia into the bloc until they had seen substantial progress in cooperation with the Yugoslavia Tribunal as well as domestic processes, because they had, from the history of Europe, it's very clear that failure to address these issues will also hamper progress in other fields. So there has become issue linkage across a range of different areas, linking progress on minority rights, on dealing with criminal processes, and setting up fair and balanced judicial processes in terms of being able to then participate in other areas of international activity, whether it's trade or economic development and others. Whether that's correct or not, this type of issue linkage is for people to assess. But the idea is that this type of linkage may be beneficial in terms of also contributing to altering state behavior. I'm not saying that the ICC's job is to change people's behavior, but I think the goal of the process is also to contribute towards inculcating a culture of a rule of law, which, again, is not idealistic, it's real politic. Where there is a failure to, or there has been difficulties in instituting this a new mindset where the people who were committing the crimes of yesterday are still in power, then these countries are often bankrupted by the continuation of a culture of violence. You see small arms and extremist rhetoric migrating from one conflict to another. In the case of the West Africa, you've seen that migration of extremist rhetoric of small arms, of use of child soldiers, go from one country to another country to another country. And we were also dealing with a situation in Cote d'Ivoire. Cote d'Ivoire was one of the most successful stories of West Africa, became exactly brought into that whole, the vestiges of the conflicts that were, the residual elements of the conflicts from some Liberia and Sierra Leone and all the rest. So these atrocities continue, they have ripple effects. So I don't think the international justice project is the only response. Definitely other responses are needed, especially if you're looking to stop atrocities. But I think it can't be dismissed as being irrelevant. And also the costs to the project. The cost for these countries in terms of the continuation of armed conflict, of the continuation of governance which is racked by corruption and armed violence or extremist rhetoric, that cost can also be considered. So I think particularly I would put forward the notion that what the ICC what the Rome Statutes is trying to do is something a bit more nuanced. I think it's trying to set up a system, a sort of international system for a response to these norms, but a system that relies primarily on re-emphasizing the responsibility at the national level. And the court is there as a catalyst, providing incentives, but also with the prospect of coercive measures in terms of intervention, if necessary. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Rastan. I'm sure that each of you also now have responses to Mr. Rastan's responses, and we can go back to that, or I can prompt a few questions.
90 seconds?
Please.
On comparison with domestic systems, probably if there were anything like the probability of prosecution at the international level that there is at the domestic level, probably I would think would have effect. There's a sort of drop in the ocean problem with the mass nature of the crimes and the small resources politically and financially and so on. Probably there's some critical point where the turn effect would kick in. You point out that we see recidivism of atrocity where there's no criminal justice process put in place, but we see it equally when there is, so I'm not sure what the effect is. I meant idealistic very positively, as unrealistic. No, really, I came to this subject many years ago, a very big supporter, and I think for reasons that are shared with people that support. The cost of continued violence to the countries, of course, but what's the evidence that this helps to stop the violence? The bigger point that you make, though, is that this is about a system of justice that has more complex effects at the national level and so on. What I don't know is what evidence there is that prosecutions at the national level, that their likelihood, their quality, that anything about them changes much because of the existence of the complementarity regime. What we typically see is if there's no regime change, there's no domestic prosecution and no cooperation with the ICC, if there is regime change, then it'll be both. And there will be the problems of victor's justice and so on.
Okay.
Very briefly, I understand, of course, the notion of the ICC sort of as a backstop for national systems. But the idea assumes that backstopping is a good thing. That is to say that the desirability of prosecution is so obvious that if governments don't undertake the prosecution, then of course it's a good thing to have a backstop. My problem with that proposition, I guess, is illustrated by the example that Professor Morris gave regarding the indictment of Charles Taylor. Now, I don't mean to criticize the prosecutor in that situation. If you're a prosecutor and you're charged with prosecuting particular crimes and you have evidence that a particular person is responsible for those crimes, it seems to me it's awfully difficult if you're a prosecutor to justify to yourself saying, I'm going to ignore what I had sworn to do and pretend it didn't happen. But one can raise the question whether there ought to be a prosecutor who is in a position, potentially, to foul up peace talks that can end atrocities in a country. It is not necessarily clear that prosecution is always desirable. And that being the case, one can ask whether the desirability of a backstop is always clear.
Your point raises what I think is the hardest question, or at least it's the one that bothers me these days about this stuff, which is, what do you do with this, you know, when you've been unfortunate enough to have somebody come into your custody? Somebody has been captured. They've been, there they are. They're knocking on your door. Do you say, we're not going to prosecute this person? In fact, we're going to do nothing. We're going to take them out back and shoot them. We're going to give them a house in the Riviera. What do you do?
Yeah, I mean,
I like taking them out and shooting.
Yeah. Well, that was Churchill's proposal after World War II, wasn't it? And then the Americans suggested it may be better to have some kind of, well, that was an expressive effect, perhaps.
And have but, a trial before but, the hanging.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think, and obviously we've seen examples in terms of where that hasn't worked, it's gone wrong. But I think also, in going back to real politics for us, I think justice is a very considerable consideration in terms of trying to move forward. The reason that NATO started arresting people in Bosnia wasn't because they suddenly turned around and decided ICTY is a good thing. For years, their number of years, they've been saying, you know, basically, we're not going to, this is not our mandate, we're not going to touch these guys. Until it was a British commander in Prieto area who was having a lot of difficulties with one of the local officials who basically was stopping the implementation of the peace process, the Dayton process, which was NATO's mandate to oversee. And basically, the liaison officers in Banja Luka, who was there from the ICTY, mentioned that, well, this guy is also wanted by the ICTY, we have a warrant out against him. So there was a convergence of interest in getting rid of this guy because he was blocking progress. So to that extent, that brings up the issue, and that was the first arrest that was done. And then this led to a ripple effect and realization that, indeed, these people are blocking the process. Milosevic, who became a peace broker during the Dayton Accords, he went on to, again, use the same extremist rhetoric in Kosovo and committed the crimes there. Now, if Milosevic had been taken out of the picture, would Kosovo still happen? Maybe, maybe not. Look at Ahmad Haroun, minister that we indicted, the Minister of Interior in Darfur, who was responsible for setting up the whole security apparatus to deal with the and who the judges issued a warrant against for the you know, reasonable basis to grounds to believe he committed war crimes and crimes against humanity. He is now Minister of Humanitarian Affairs for Darfur. He is the guy who is responsible for the victims that he displaced. He is the guy responsible for the humanitarian access. He is the guy who gives also, who's blocking humanitarian assistance and whose role is to interact with the same NGOs that have now been thrown out. So we're talking about individuals who, if you leave them to remain in the picture, if Charles Taylor, for example, was still in the picture in Liberia, would we have the type of stability we have in the region or not? I don't know. But these are not just nice guys who will easily respond to, you know, being bought off by a deal and happy retirement. This type of extremist rhetoric will have major implications for entire regions. So there may be some beneficial effect to having these guys taken out of the picture by exposing them to a criminal process in the same way that you would want domestically. I think the expectation is you have a criminal who's accused of committing mass atrocities. You don't just co-opt them into then some kind of a happy arrangement with the authorities. You basically, you know, you consider that their removal and their ability to have such influential roles in society. And here you have people who are influential in determining regional peace and security, that there are some beneficial impact that the justice process can make. Now, this isn't regime change, but it is a question of the impact of criminal prosecutions on the marginalization of these people, people like Šešelj, also in the former Yugoslavia, other extremist characters, and that there is some beneficial impact that could be had to broader processes. That isn't the primary goal of international justice, again, I want to recall. But if you're looking at the bigger impacts, I think there's something to be acknowledged there.
May I just?
Sure.
I just want to say, it's impossible to disagree with anything that Raj has said. My point is, though, that remember what we're dealing with the ICC, is an absolute presumption that providing the evidence exists, prosecution is always advisable. And that's a very different thing from saying being able to point out situations where prosecution is very necessary. I mean, just to point out what you said, you characterized Milosevic as a peace broker at Dayton. Suppose he'd been taken into custody before Dayton. Not after, but before. One can at least ask the question whether the impact on ending the war in Bosnia would have been advanced by that. I don't think it's absurd to wonder if perhaps that would have made things more difficult rather than less difficult.
I think it's literally, but I think it's what you ask prosecutors to do, and I think that's the issue. I agree that there are broader processes. For example, in the Rome Statute system, and this was a controversial aspect of the negotiations, was should there be a role for somebody to have oversight in terms of prosecutorial discretion and some type of executive oversight. So in the system as negotiated by states that we try to implement, that role is given to the Security Council. The Security Council under Article 16 can basically ask the court to suspend its activities if they perceive that there's a threat to international peace and security. And that was foreseen as something that would be a very exceptional extreme situation that would be invoked. So I think that role is for people who are more wise or who have the responsibility to do that. I don't think you should expect prosecutors to determine how international. No, I'm not saying you are, but I'm saying I think one should not expect prosecutors to have to balance those considerations, because I think if they did, they would then become political actors. They would be saying, well, in this situation, we should proceed when we have evidence, and this situation we shouldn't because of the political implications. So I think we have to have a process that's objective, that's led by evidence. There is elements of prosecutorial discretion still within that, obviously, but that should be exercised within objective parameters. And then those broader questions, I think, are valid to be put out there, but they're for others to take, and not us.
Great. I think we've heard the panelists speak broadly about international criminal law, and then more specifically about some of the courts. What I'd like to do now is move more specifically into this situation we have here. Mr. Rastan spoke about measured and precise action by the ICC, and I would pose the question to each of the panelists: do you think that in issuing the arrest warrant for the first time against a sitting head of state in the March 4th decision regarding President Bashir of Sudan, the ICC has done that? Have they set a precedent for criminal law? And is this legal regime change in a way? How can we assess this precedent in the instant situation? Anyone can start.
I would say at this point we can't. The warrant has only just been issued. I wouldn't bet my house on it, but I suppose it's possible that when Bashir lands in Qatar, he will be arrested and turned over to the court. That is not physically impossible, at least. And to make any kind of overall assessment is difficult. I will point out one thing about it, though. Not only do we have the effects on the ground to which Professor Morris made reference earlier, but one of the ironies of the issuance of the arrest warrant has manifested itself on the level of the expressive function. What we've had is the African Union and the League of Arab States express their dismay that the warrant was issued. That is to say, what we now have is an example of some degree of state practice saying, in effect, well, maybe these behaviors, however unfortunate they are, don't really justify arresting somebody. That too is a legal precedent, and I'm not sure that that's necessarily a positive one.
I mean, of course, it's a precedent for the ICC, but two other heads of state have been previously indicted, as we discussed earlier. Both Milosevic and Charles Taylor were in power, were sitting heads of state when they were indicted. They were only arrested after. They were no longer heads of state. I think in terms of, our focus response, if you like. Well, our we've mentioned previously that our prosecutorial policy that we've adopted, that we've announced, is that we will seek to bring focused investigations, focused cases, but directed to the persons most responsible, depending on the evidence. And in the initial phase, our evidence took us as high as a state minister of the interior, Ahmed Haroun. And then since then, we've continued to gather evidence, which took us right within the heart of the governmental structure. And at that level, we identify the person most responsible with the authority to control the commission of the crimes to be the president. It doesn't mean that we're going to spend, another 20, 30 years necessarily in Sudan. We're trying to have a precise and focused intervention in terms of the criminal process, and that may lead on to other domestic actions or not. But the degree to which the court will bring forward cases in relation to Sudan is we'll see how that plays out in the coming years. I think in terms of the position of the Arab League and African Union, it's interesting because neither regional group has said that there's no crimes being committed in Darfur. They haven't said that there should be no prosecution. They've called for the end of impunity, and they've called for responses to deal with this process. But I think the broader question they've raised is more, is this fair in terms of why are you targeting one of the heads of state from our regional bloc and not others? So actually, if anything, their demand is for a universal approach to these issues. Whereas I think the question that they've seen is that there is selectivity, and is that selectivity tied to other agendas and Western agendas, the Security Council's agenda, and things like that, which I think are legitimate questions to be asked. I mean, for us as a court, we can obviously respond that it's a question of jurisdiction. We have jurisdiction in this situation. Particularly here in Sudan, we have a jurisdiction because of the Security Council, but in many other situations, we don't have jurisdiction. Now, is that correct or not? Well, that's the system set up by the Rome Statute. We have a treaty-based jurisdiction, which is based upon states joining the regime, the Rome Statute regime. And we have a jurisdiction that's tied to Chapter 7 decisions of the Security Council, which will be made on the basis of the decisions of the Council, which is a political body. So that's the system that we have, so we can answer it. But that's me. But so I think the question that they raise is it goes to that issue about this project should be applied equally to all. And I think in private also that is the perception that we've seen. So I don't think the Arab League and African Union is saying there should be no accountability for crimes in Darfur. I think they're saying this should be done across the board, and they see this as a sort of a selective approach, which is a legitimate question. But I think then this invites all countries to join the Rome Statute, so the court is empowered to deal with all situations around the world on an equal basis, and then justice, the rule of law standards, will be applied equally to all. And I think that's the challenge for the ICC. Until that happens, then these criticisms will continue. But the goal, I think, must be that, to have the same standard for all situations.
The majority of those states are non-members, yes?
Well, of the African Union, actually, the majority of sub-Saharan Africa are state parties, and they're the largest bloc that we have. Within North Africa and the sort of the Arab states, we have only one state that's, it's only Jordan that's a state party, and then two smaller states, Djibouti and Comoros Islands. But a number of them are signatories to the Rome Statute, but most of them are not state parties. So, but it's interesting because those very same states asked for ICC intervention in other situations, in Iraq, mm-hmm. in Lebanon, in Palestine. So, so the question again goes to the fact that the court is a legal instrument. It's a neutral legal instrument which has been established by the international community to deal with these situations. Whether states decide to make, to seek resort to the court is a decision that they will make. They can join the system by providing treaty-based jurisdiction, or they can vote in the context of the Security Council to refer certain situations to the court. But the court is there as a legal tool. So we have this sort of strange dilemma where some countries are asking us not to proceed where we have jurisdiction, and are asking us to proceed where we don't have jurisdiction. So for us, I mean, we can only apply the law, and then it will be for each state to decide whether or not they want to participate in the system or not. So we'll see.
Excellent. I think from there, move on to a more free-ranging question that you mentioned Charles Taylor and Milosevic and that they were indicted. Do you think that President Bashir will ever have to appear in court, or will it just be Mr. Bashir? And if so, what do you think the likely arrest scenario would be? Professor Morris.
What's his term in office?
He's been there
20
years.
His
20th anniversary will be this coming June 30th.
I'll have to have a party.
Yeah, it depends on the elections and if they're held.
How old is he?
I mean, there's been people have said, people have said also, if you get rid of Bashir, then somebody else will come up in his place and will affect. I think let's see if what happens in terms of the particular allegations against Bashir. But I think anybody who let's say if Bashir is brought before the court and somebody else takes his place within the government structures, I think they will be aware that the ICC is here as a tool. So if crimes continue to be committed, then there is that prospect. So whether that will have a deterrent impact or not on government authorities deciding to deal with insurgency situations through mass atrocities as opposed to other mechanisms, we'll see. I mean, it's not necessarily going to make people better people, but they might decide to resort to more lawful means to deal with those types of situations.
The difficulty with that is it cuts both ways. If he appears before the ICC, particularly if he appears before his term is over, I think the possibility you identify is certainly a reasonable one. If, however, he serves out his term, goes into an honored retirement in Sudan, and dies surrounded by his family and gets a wonderful state funeral, I think the message that's going to be sent is an ICC indictment and we'll buy you a cup of coffee, provided you also have a dollar.
I think it's a challenge. I mean, you see the situation in Cambodia where Pol Pot died before there was a justice mechanism, and now you have very aged accused facing trial, and the worry that they may in fact pass away before the end of the criminal process. Mm-hmm. But then you see people like Radovan Karadzic, who nobody thought would it be impossible to have him in court, and then a few months ago he's arrested and he's been living a life as a spiritualist, a teacher guru with a beard, and if that's what he's been reduced to, I mean that's or Milosevic, who spends his last years in custody. Regret that he passed away before there was a determination on his innocence or guilt, but I think you can't discount the effect of an international warrant against the ability of a head of state to continue things as usual. They're stigmatized and marginalized on the international level. Possibly that may also have effects for their authority more closer to home. But also the point for us is that we're a permanent court. We're not going away. We the victims can't afford the luxury of waiting. They want to see a response, and they're often left out of these discussions to some extent. But we, as a permanent court, we can wait. 2 months, 2 years, 20 years.
The Security Council referral, does it, I don't recall that it does, it speak directly to the question of head of state immunity?
Yeah, no, it doesn't. It's an interesting question that's been raised because as we know, under customary international law and the law of state immunities at the national level, we know state officials, particularly head of state, and those who have similar capacities like the Minister of Foreign Affairs, their immunity is inviolable, and they can't be subject to criminal process. And that was the Eurodio case of the ICJ between Congo and Belgium. But the ICJ had said that where an international criminal court has jurisdiction, such as the ICC, then that immunity would not subsist. Now, the issue is in this situation, the government of Sudan, or the Sudanese state, they are not bound by the Rome Statute because they're not part of the treaty regime. So they're not required to cooperate with the court pursuant to the Rome Statute. They're required to cooperate with the court pursuant to the resolution of the Security Council, which was adopted under Chapter 7. And because they're a member of the UN Charter system, they're obliged under Article 25 of the UN Charter to carry out the decisions of the Security Council adopted under Chapter 7. So the point is, so what obligations are created for Sudan pursuant to that resolution? And it's an interesting question. I've seen some academic discussion out there. I mean, we also will obviously have to address this issue in court at some stage. But I think for us, the assumption is that when the Security Council decides that the government of Sudan and other parties of the conflict shall cooperate fully with the ICC, it creates obligations for the Sudan towards the court, and the court will apply its legal regime in relation to the situation. The Security Council doesn't say cooperate fully with the court, and the court shall only apply this portion of its statute. The court has a legal regime, which the Council was aware of, and that regime includes Article 27, which says that there is no immunity based upon official capacity, the irrelevance of official capacity, which is arguably also established in customary international law. So I think the position that a head of state doesn't have immunity before an international criminal court is perhaps not controversial. Maybe it can be still questioned, but I think that's relatively not controversial. The issue is, does that head of state enjoy immunity from a legal process in another country as part of the surrender process? You know, when he's, let's say, if he's detained and arrested in a third state, and that third state tries to surrender him to the ICC, is that third state violating its horizontal obligations towards the Sudan as opposed to the vertical obligations Sudan has towards the court? That's a broader question. I think for us, we would argue that the surrendering state, the third state, is not violating its obligations towards the Sudan because in the case of Bashir has no immunity before the court. Therefore, the Sudanese state has no immunity claim to bring in front of the third state. Therefore, the third state that's surrendering Bashir would not be violating state immunities. But it's it's an arguable cause. I mean, we can also see how the relevant states would respond. But that interpretation of immunities is I think the one that we would give.
I'd like to prompt the question of from a non-legal point of view. Do you feel that issuing the arrest warrant for President Bashir was the right decision, particularly in light of the expulsion of aid groups and NGOs from the Sudan and the effect that it's invariably going to have on the population of Sudan?
No.
I think that, at least initially, I'm going to perhaps steal some of Mr. Rastan's thunder. The problem with talking about it from a non-legal point of view is that the court doesn't have the luxury, the prosecutor doesn't have the luxury of approaching it from a non-legal point of view. If you want to deal with the policy question of whether heads of state in situations like this, who are in a position and who are known to have the inclination to do this sort of thing, whether they should be arrested, then the way to approach that is to address this whole notion of how you want to structure the international criminal justice system and whether at some level discretion for policy questions ought to be built in. I mean, I would certainly agree it's not up to the prosecutor to make that decision. The difficulty with saying it was up to the prosecutor would be that, in essence, you would be turning what is supposed to be a legal institution into something that is beyond that. The question, though, that to my mind is, what does that tell us about the costs as well as the benefits of creating the legal institution. I would say one thing more about this. One of the things that I believe is unfortunate about this whole event, and again, this is not something that can be laid at the feet of the court, we're not talking about what's necessary to straighten things out in Darfur. We're talking about, is it a good thing that this particular legal proceeding has gone forward? And in some ways, frankly, I think that not only reflects what one might expect normal professional tunnel vision from lawyers to be, but also a shrinking from the acceptance of the consequences of the principles that we claim we hold. I said this before, I'll repeat it. If we really think that genocide is such a bad thing, even if it's happening to people we don't know a long way away, then we ought to be prepared to do something about it. And by do something, let me make clear, I mean, if that means you subjugate Sudan, raise an army of 10 million people, if that's necessary, then you do it, because you say there is nothing worse than genocide. If there's nothing worse than genocide, then you do it. If you don't do it, then whatever you say, you don't believe there's nothing worse than genocide.
Mark, what about the interests of justice provision? Doesn't that give some leeway on this?
Yeah, I mean, it's a question that we have this provision, for those who don't know, it says that as part of the discretionary choices of the prosecution in terms of whether or not to proceed with an investigation, or the prosecution, the prosecutor will also consider the interest of justice. And it's an undefined term. People say it's like a public interest type of consideration. I mean, we've put out a policy paper trying to put forward what we think, how it should be defined, and we've invited a discussion on the point to see whether or not, you know, there should be other considerations. But we've defined it as the interest of justice strictly defined, not the interest of international peace and security, because that's the function that belongs to the Security Council or to others. So, for example, it might be because of the age of the individual, because of particular circumstances relating to whether or not we want to proceed with this particular prosecution or rather that one. So there are the legal considerations relating to the judicial process rather than peace and security as such. I think the day that, as was mentioned by Mark, the day that we entertain those non-legal considerations, then I think we are exposing ourselves to a lot of danger as objective actors.
Excellent. I think on that point, I'd like to open up to the audience for any questions that you may have.
I was hoping that maybe we could explore the question of interest of justice, and particularly Mr. Rastan, if you could answer to some of the goals of prosecution, you know, the traditional goals of prosecution, the retribution, rehabilitation, et cetera. What is the interest of justice vis-a-vis those goals, and what does prosecution at the international level bring towards accomplishing those goals?
It's building on the last point we were discussing. I mean, it's interesting the way it's phrased. It's in Article 53, which relates to the decision of the prosecutor to proceed with opening an investigation in relation to a situation. And the interest of justice is introduced as a countervailing consideration. So the first two issues that you have to establish, that there's a reasonable basis to believe that crimes within the jurisdiction of the court have occurred, obviously. And then secondly, that any cases arising from the situation or the relevant cases that that would be the focus of prosecutorial attention would be admissible, meaning that, that either there is not an issue relating to complementarity at the national level. National courts are an examination of whether or not national courts are unwilling or unable to genuinely proceed with the cases, or whether there's any inactivity at the national level. So those questions of admissibility and complementarity also have to be assessed. And obviously, if there is a genuine domestic process, then the presumption should be that the prosecutor would not be required to proceed also in the light that, that there would likely be challenges anyway to the admissibility of the case. So it doesn't make sense to focus resources on a situation where the national authorities are dealing quite competently with an issue. So then after, if those two considerations have been answered positively, there is jurisdiction and the cases arising from the situation would be admissible, then as a countervailing consideration, are there nonetheless reasons to believe that it wouldn't be in the interest of justice to proceed? So we don't have to establish that the prosecutions or investigations would be in the interest of justice. It's assumed that you would proceed if there is jurisdiction of visibility, but there would be reasons why it would not be in the interest of justice. And then it's given some reasons. It says, taking into account the gravity, there are nonetheless substantial reasons to believe it would not serve the interest of justice. Where we decide not to proceed solely on the basis of the interest of justice, it's interesting also that that type of prosecutorial discretion, which appears to be very wide, is subject to judicial supervision. So the provision relating to interest of justice state that where it's done solely on the basis of interest of justice, the pretrial chamber, three judges, will review that decision. And the decision of the prosecutor will only be confirmed if the judges agree. So the judges might say, actually, we don't think you've assessed your discretion correctly in terms of the interest of justice in this situation, We request you to revisit your assessment.
Can I get clarification? So any time an investigation has been opened, if the prosecutor finds there's not sufficient evidence, then it never gets before the pretrial chamber. But if the determination is that there is or may be sufficient evidence, but the case will not be pursued because of the interests of justice, then specifically the prosecutor is obliged to go before the pretrial chamber?
Yeah. There's two procedures. One is about the initiation of an investigation to a situation at all. So let's say we've got the Darfur referral and the prosecutor decides whether or not to open an investigation. So that's the decision we take. And then after the investigation is opened, about whether or not to proceed with any prosecutions. Mm-hmm. So at the first stage, if the prosecutor, for example, in relation to the Security Council referral, or the referral from, I don't know, DRC, from the Congo, or from anywhere else, decided, looked at the issue and said, okay, there appears to be crimes within the jurisdictional court, yes, tick. Cases would be admissible because inaction or lack of genuineness in terms of ability and willingness, check. However, I'm still not gonna proceed because it's not serving the interest of justice. And therefore, I'm not gonna open an investigation, and that's my decision. Then the pretrial chamber would have the authority to examine that discretionary decision and to review it. And then it says here that, where is it? It's in 53, paragraph 3. The pretrial chamber may review the decision of the prosecutor not to proceed. And it says that in, let's just, this is 3B. The pretrial chamber may, on its own initiative, review a decision of the prosecutor not to proceed if it is based solely on paragraphs 1C or 2C. This is interest and justice. In such a case, the decision of the prosecutor shall only be effective if confirmed by the pretrial chamber. So because this is an element of such broad discretion that's built into the statute, during the negotiations, it was considered that there should be some supervision of that particular element of prosecutor discretion. That's a very discreet power. Generally, the prosecutor's discretion is not subject to review of that kind, because it's the usual function that a prosecutor is independent in deciding, determining the focus of his investigative strategy, his prosecutor strategy, and all the rest. But here, because it would be a countervailing consideration to proceeding, so basically you decided not to proceed with prosecutions or investigations, then it was considered that that should enjoy at least some consensus with the judges.
Could you provide some hypothetical examples of what sorts of considerations might move the prosecutor to think that, notwithstanding the admissibility of the case, the evidence, and so on, it was nonetheless not in the interest of justice to proceed?
I'd invite you to have a look. I can forward our policy paper on the issue, but I think we've been quite cautious not to give hypothetical examples, because obviously we don't want to prejudice future litigation, but also it's very difficult because circumstances will change case by case and all the rest. But, the scenarios in which this type of discretion has been exercised in the past at the domestic level has been, for example, the age of the accused or something like that, the goals of prosecution will be better served in relation to a different prosecution or a different scenario. So I think beyond that, it will be very difficult for us to give concrete examples because we don't want to prejudice ourselves also. Sure. But what we've said is that we've defined the parameters of how we will consider this issue, and we've defined them very narrowly related to the judicial process, not to broader questions of international peace and security. Because people were saying to us, for example, in relation to northern Uganda, the prosecutor should not proceed with prosecution against Joseph Kony because he's threatening to not sign the peace agreement, and therefore the prosecutor should use his powers under the interests of justice. Whereas others have said to us, well, it's directly as a result of the prosecutor's indictment of Joseph Kony that there's been a sharp drop in attacks, and Joseph Kony has lost his support in southern Sudan and in Uganda. I think there were two processes that actually led to Joseph Kony losing his support base. One was the signing of the North-South Peace Agreement, obviously, and losing his support in the South as a proxy in that sort of ongoing protracted violence in the region. And then secondly, the indictment by the ICC. ICG and others have said that these two things seem to have converged in terms of Kony losing his support. So that has... If you're looking for an impact on victims in northern Uganda, people acknowledge that was a process that really helped to bring Kony, or take him away from violence in terms of northern Uganda and bring him to the negotiating table. But then now people saying, well, that purpose now has exhausted itself because now he won't sign unless the warrant is lifted. Whereas we're saying, well, he's now blackmailing you. He's saying, I'll commit more crimes unless you grant me immunity. And one could look at the situation with Bashir, whether or not that is a similar situation where he's saying, you know, I'm throwing out aid agencies, I'm threatening to throw out peacekeepers, and precipitating a crisis to international peace and security unless you grant me, basically.
Well, he is doing that. But
yeah, so it's a self-induced threat.
But not to the victims. It's being induced by him. He is in the wrong. What he's doing is despicable. That doesn't mean that it isn't predictable and a consequence of the indictment and the arrest warrant.
Oh, yeah, no, absolutely. It's a direct consequence. But I think one could look at to see whether or not a justice mechanism or judicial process should be set aside as a result of self-induced threats to peace and security, whereas somebody like Joseph Kony or here, basically, it's like a situation of blackmail.
Absolutely. It's terrible. But that doesn't make it any different. And in other words, yes, it's his fault. It's his fault. But so what?
But it might belie his genocidal intent even.
If I could make a point here, and I think that as between the positions taken by Professor Morris and Mr. Rastan, I agree with both of them. And to my way of thinking, it illustrates one of the problems of attempting to analogize criminal proceedings against somebody who is in control of the state apparatus to criminal proceedings against an individual, even an organized crime leader, in domestic law. The fact of the matter is that people who are in control of the state apparatus have much more capacity to do harm in an effort to somehow finesse the system than do individuals in a domestic system. Which means, once again, one of the things you have to factor in when you're thinking about setting up an international court is that potentially you're going to be dealing with people who are in a position to do exactly this sort of thing. It goes once again to the pluses and minuses of the institution.
That's all.
Yeah. It makes the challenge for such a court and tribunal very, very real, I think. And that's, I recognize, I mean, the issues that you mentioned are of course, very real, important considerations and questions of life and death for victims. But from my perspective, we would say equally the issue of having accountability and removing these dangerous characters from the process is an issue of life and death as well. And I think the evidence discovery process cannot be determined by the position of the accused, the fact that he is a head of state or in power, would cause us to have different objective considerations to whether or not he's a rebel commander. Because then what are we? We're just going after rebels. We're basically, you know, then that also doesn't make sense either. So, but there are important questions to be raised.
Matt, did you have a question?
I have no legal background, so some of this I miss, but I think from a position of sort of energetic or creative diplomacy, the court statute in action brings some options that you can use in diplomacy that can be valuable. one I'd like to mention is Article 16, because obviously that's the one that's been most discussed in the AU and the Arab League and everywhere else. And it's a technical question about that, and that is, as I understand it, that provision is for deferral for up to 1 year. Most people in the diplomatic community that I've talked to about this think, obviously, deferral for a year is too much in the case of Bashir, but have talked about using a lesser time frame. Is that okay under the statute?
Or is yeah, I mean, the statute indeed says it can be up to a year, and then it can be renewed. So it says, it says for a period of 12 months, but presumably the council could request, I think it would be open, let's say, to interpretation that the council might request for a shorter period. But the important thing, I think, also to stress is that the power under Article 16 is one of suspending the proceedings. It's not about divesting jurisdiction. The court has jurisdiction and will continue to have jurisdiction. And that's often also missed, I think, in the discussions. And also the conditions for the adoption of a resolution is that it has to be adopted under Chapter 7, so that requires a majority vote within the council and no vetoes of that. So the way it was phrased, I mean, the negotiation of Article 16 were very protracted and as you all know, very, very controversial. But the way it's been framed, it's quite a unique set of circumstances have to exist to meet the criteria for Article 16, and it was foreseen that it would be used exceptionally. Whether or not it will be utilized here, we'll see. And whether or not the court's intervention may have implications for the broader processes of how countries resolve, and approach issues of conflict resolution and diplomacy and all the rest. I mean, that's where others were much better placed to consider. But it does introduce a different factor into the discussions. It brings in a rule of law factor, which may be welcomed or not, but it complicates the situation for negotiators. This is a new reality that the court is now, on this international landscape. It's not going to go away, and the reality is that for good or for bad, international negotiators and interlocutors, state representatives, have to also adjust to that reality that the legal process has to be factored in. These longer term considerations.
Matt.
Looking just to give the court as an institution in terms of its future as an institution and its young history up to this point, it seems like one criticism that I often hear voiced of the ICC is the power of the issue of enforcement and the issue of its varying jurisdiction and the cooperation. Corroborative of the validity of the court's
if I may respond, I understand your analogy, but I think there is a serious flaw in it. Congress can address interstate crime. You don't have to get everybody in Congress to agree. 50% plus one in each house will deal with the problem you're addressing. To the extent that you're talking about a non-party state and the risk that it won't arrest someone, there exists no international institution that by majority rule can compel non-party states to take part in the process. Indeed, I may say this is that speaks to a broader question about international judicial institutions anyway, not by any manner of means, just the International Criminal Court, but any international judicial institution. To the extent that problems reveal themselves in the way the jurisdiction of the institution is defined and the way its authority is defined, to the extent that the tribunal hands down a decision that seems to a great many people to be just wrong-headed. You don't have the availability of a legislature to deal with those problems. You're more or less stuck with what you have. And that, to my mind, is a serious problem.
It's not just that there isn't a legislature. There isn't a legislature because there isn't a polity. There isn't a underlying political unity such that a legislature has been created. Mm-hmm. And it's a much bigger question whether that's good, bad, indifferent, or just the way it is, or going to change.
Yeah, we have a mature institution, if you like, a court that's set up to a very technical process according to law and procedure, sitting in an underdeveloped international system where it can't rely on the normal powers that a court tribunal would rely on. So I think it does raise fundamental questions, absolutely. We recognize that. We have said that it's a major challenge of these international courts and tribunals. But also it brings in the question, what are the underlying values of the international community? If, for example, in expressions, for example, R2P, which we will discuss later, that you know the international community has said, you know, that by consensus they agree that there are fundamental norms regarding atrocity crimes that the international community must respond to, and these have been identified, you know, the prevention of genocide, crimes against humanity, war crimes, as core shared interests. But yet states are not willing to so realign their national interests to actually take action to prevent the crimes occurring or to stop their continuation, then the question, you know, then the credibility of that premise is brought into doubt. You know, these are either the shared fundamental values that we all align our national interests to, or they're just expressions of pious good intentions. So absolutely, I mean, the court raises a number of interesting questions about the international system that is emerging, that's developing. It's kind of a slightly, you know, interesting formation that's come about, but it's not the end process, presumably. I mean,
why presume that?
Well, I mean, because I think the challenge of an international court that has to continue relying on this type of system where enforcement is not guided by necessary legal considerations, not automatic, but relies on discrete decisions of state to decide on to enforce certain decisions based upon national interests at a particular time, as you're saying, that you know maybe political considerations may dictate whether or not a court is effective. That type of system in the long term, or even in the short term, raises fundamental questions about the credibility or the predictability of the enforcement of law. And so either we may see a movement towards a situation where consensus does converge around the fact of the need for compliance with these fundamental norms, as is emerging perhaps through the R2P discussion, although that's obviously still a very young concept in many ways, or other structures are created to assist with these processes. For example, in the European context, they talk about a rapid reaction force that can go in at the request of states and assist in terms of, for example, what happened in Sierra Leone. The British went in and assisted in stabilizing the situation there in the context of the Congo during the elections a couple of years back. the European Union sent in troops at the request of the DRC to help pacify and to calm down the situation in the east of the country to help with the elections. These types of responses may be increasingly considered if we're going to try to set about a rule of law, justice-based world order. I mean, this is a very, you know, it's a project that's still, you know, it's in the very early stages, but the court raises questions if that's the direction we're heading towards, or whether the court is actually a blip from the usual course of activities and it's not the direction we're going in. So, those fundamental questions are also raised by the mere existence of now a permanent international criminal court.
I see that due to an excellent and open discussion by our panelists, we've run a bit over time, so please join me in thanking them.